Well, the Europe of nations or the Europe of Brussels? Democratic nationalism or transnational oligarchy? For more than a half a century, the Europe of Brussels has sought to supplant, to replace the Europe of nations. Within a decade of the Treaty of Rome, which founded the European Community, the European Court of Justice in the mid-60s established the superiority of the supranational court over national courts and over democratic parliaments. Then came the Single European Act, followed by the Maastricht Treaty, which created the European Union, the Euro, and finally the Lisbon Treaty. The substantive policies of the Europe of Brussels have attempted to transform four key pillars of European civilization: the nation, Christianity, democracy, and liberalism. The Brussels project is post-national, post-Christian, post-democratic, and even post-liberal. It subordinated national sovereignty and refused to recognize Christianity's role in the formation of European civilization. It has, in general, given decision-making authority to bureaucrats and judges, and it specifically removed the democratically elected leaders, such as Berlusconi in Italy. Everyone recognizes that it has a democracy deficit. Further, the Europe of Brussels cannot be considered traditionally liberal, even in terms of free speech and individual rights. Hate speech laws are used to prevent criticism of radical Islam. Chancellor Merkel meets with Facebook CEO Mark Zuckerberg, and she's searching for ways to censor opponents of her migration policy, to silence them. Moreover, substantive policies regarding families, gender, social justice, and the like are closer to the agenda of the 1968ers than the founders, than the vision of Schuman, De Gasperi, Adenauer, and the founders of the European communities. But today, the Europe of nations, that is democratic nationalism, envisioned by Charles de Gaulle and Margaret Thatcher, is reemerging, both intellectually and politically. Remember that for years, de Gaulle fought with the European Commission chief, Walter Hallstein, and just as Thatcher fought with Jacques Delors, the same sort of battles about sovereignty and transnationalism. In her famous Bruges speech in 1988, Thatcher declared that, quote, active cooperation between independent sovereign states, that's independent sovereign states, is the best way to build a successful European community. To try to suppress nationhood and concentrate power at the center of a European conglomerate would jeopardize the objects we seek, unquote. A few years ago, a group of leading European intellectuals, including Roger Scruton, who will speak a little later, Pierre Manon, Richard Legutko, Chantal Delsol, René Braigue, and others, issued the Paris Declaration, A Europe We Can Believe In. The Paris Statement declared, quote, the true Europe is a community of nations. We have our own languages, traditions, and borders. Yet we have always recognized a kinship one with another, unquote. The Paris Statement also calls for the need to, quote, throw off the tyranny of the false Europe and its utopian pseudo-religious crusade for a borderless world, unquote. Now, the Paris Statement uses the term oligarchy to describe the current state of the EU regime. Indeed, the choice is often oligarchy versus democracy. This cuts to the heart of the matter. The political renaissance of the Europe of Nations, democratic nationalism, is manifest in support for Brexit and for a range of political forces endorsing democratic sovereignty in the forthcoming European elections. These forces are not always in agreement on economics, on foreign policy, and many other issues. Some are Thatcherite. Some are Gaullist. Some are sophisticated. Some are not. Some are traditional and classical liberal. Some are given the nebulous term of populist, which is always a derogatory epithet. Interestingly, the Paris Statement declared, we have our reservations about populism because Europe needs to draw on the deep wisdom of her traditions. Nevertheless, quote, we acknowledge that much in this new political phenomenon can represent a healthy rebellion against the tyranny of the false Europe, which labels as anti-democratic any threat to the monopoly of its moral legitimacy, unquote. But the core moral issue is who governs, self-governing democratic peoples or undemocratic supranational authorities. Referring to the European community in 1957, Pierre Mondès France, later a premier of France, declared, "A democrat may abdicate by giving in to an internal dictatorship, but also by delegating its powers to an external authority." Clement Attlee once stated, and yes, I'm quoting Clement Attlee favorably, that Britain would not accept that the most vital economic forces in the country be turned over to a supranational authority that is utterly democratic and is responsible to nobody. So the issue is, in the end, not pro or anti-Europe, but a Europe of nations or a Europe of Brussels, democratic nationalism or transnational oligarchy. Thank you.